All right, it took me a little bit to catch up, but I'm finally here in episode 7. Ooh, so much to discuss. Hey, all my charmed friends, welcome back to The Turnout. I am your host, Loy. Don't forget to check out our website, usaaudiences.com, for special event and movie screening invites. And follow us on Twitter at TheTurnoutUSAA. I'm always on there talking about stuff. Sometimes it's charmed, sometimes it's other stuff that we're working on. I have a lot of videos that we're currently gonna get gearing up for the new year, so hopefully we'll be able to do some fun stuff there. So episode 7, it was... You know, I say it's a doozy a lot in these videos, but man, this one, it sent me kind of going crazy. It has a lot of different moving parts going on. It involves returning characters, friends that you once thought were friends turning their backs on you, and all kinds of stuff. Like, I can't wait to go over this episode with you. Before I do that, don't forget to hit like, subscribe to the channel, hit the bell notification so you always know when The Turnout puts out another video. And yeah, and that's it. So let's go on to the episode now. So this episode is split up differently. There are 3 different storylines going on, and it's cool because these are all kind of storylines that are following up on things that they kind of ignored last episode. That was actually kind of the thing before I even jump into what happened this episode. Last episode, they didn't talk at all to Abigail. They didn't talk about Kat at all, even though we were supposed to have learned the truth about Kat. And just generally, it felt like they were dropping a lot of balls in terms of the writing. Like, they were like, there's not enough time to include these other storylines. But in my opinion, like, they had just heard that Kat was talking to their mom and her spirit and stuff. Like, why wasn't that something they, like, immediately followed up on? I don't know, it's just, I think possibly the last couple episodes took place within a short time frame, and maybe that's why. I just felt like, oh man, I couldn't wait for them to finally go ahead and cover this, and then they did. They came back to those storylines that they were kind of ignoring in this episode, so I was happy about that. So let's go ahead and go with the first one. The first one's Mel, and Mel tries to follow up with Kat to figure out what is going on with her. When she shows up, her magic shop is being packed up by Kat's mom, who is going to admit her to a facility because Kat's been hearing voices since she was little. And Mel figures out, oh, it's because she's a medium. Okay, but now I just have to convince her of that. She needs to know that she's not crazy. They have this whole thing where they hide from her mom and she takes her to her house so she can show her videos of their mom, Marisol, and like, I heard that voice. Like, yeah, I know. I saw the worms too. But she didn't reveal that she was a witch, which I thought was kind of interesting. I thought that she was going to. In the end, Kat decided, like, I'm still gonna go ahead and leave. I feel like I have not been useful for the storyline and the season so far. So I feel like the writer should go ahead and write me out. So I'm gonna leave, but I'm gonna give you my store. Here are the keys. And I'm not gonna sign over deeds or tell you who to call to pay the rent or anything, but here you go. But I guess paying the rent's pretty easy because Maggie is the assistant manager, so I guess they know where to pay the rent. But still, you know what I'm saying. Like, she didn't help her with, like, inventory. Like, I've worked in a bookstore before, and it was actually a metaphysical bookstore. So I had specific, like, distributors for those types of books, and the trinkets, like the crystals and the necklaces and stuff, you had to get those from different people. Like, you didn't give Mel any tools to run this shop. I'm just saying, it's a little annoying. Coming from somebody who has worked in a shop like that, that is annoying. Those little details, it sucks to not have those at least covered a bit. Like, she didn't even say something like, call me next week and I'll run you through the numbers or something like that. It was just like, here's the keys, bah. But there was a scene that I want to go ahead and talk about real quick, because I've said a few times, like, Mel didn't seem like she was into Kat. And they were trying to, like, play it off like, oh, well, Mel's just really, like, not wanting to get close to anybody because she doesn't want them to be hurt and all that stuff. And I'm like, it really just feels like Mel is not into it. And then they finally had, like, a kiss, and I was not feeling this kiss at all. Like, there was zero chemistry between the two actors. So honestly, in my opinion, Kat wasn't really contributing much, and there wasn't much of a love connection there because there was no chemistry. So I'm actually kind of happy Kat's gone. Nothing against the actress. You know, she was doing a good job with what she was given, but I don't feel like it played well on the show. I'm saving Maggie for last, and you'll know why in a second, but I'm moving on to Harry and Macy, and they are trying to follow up on Jordan. So like, ooh, so we know that we has this ring, we need to figure out what's wrong. Maggie steals some of his sweat so they can do like a DNA scan, and they find out that he's cursed, and they look him up, and they find out all the males in his family are cursed to die before they hit the age of 26. They will all die at the age of 25 in some part. And if I had guessed, I would have guessed, I don't know, maybe like late 20s, maybe early 30s, but he actually is 24, so he's playing older in this role. Total news to me. Anyway, Macy and Harry decide that they need to get the ring in order to make this happen, and they make a potion where they can copy things, duplication, so that's cool. And there's this really just uncomfortable scene of Macy like trying to trick Jordan into like not looking while Harry duplicates the ring. I feel like Jordan's getting very angry and frustrated with these people who keep bothering him. Like, at the beginning of the episode, he's like, did Maggie just steal my towel for, why did she steal my towel? It was for the sweat. And then she gets sucker punched by Macy while this dude who's Macy's friend is hanging out over his bag. You know, again, going back to Maggie's like, well, no, I think you shouldn't get the job. And he's tried to play it off nice. But like, I mean, essentially they are stalking him. They are non-consensually touching him constantly. They are acting like they're stealing from him and actually stealing from him. And you know what? I feel like he's getting that. And they're gonna probably, in the next episode after this, probably try to paint him like he's being so unreasonable and it's his witch hunter blood in him that's making him hate us. And I'm like, no, y'all keep messing with this guy. That's why he doesn't like you guys. Anyway, I feel like they revealed some stuff here about Jordan, and the actor's name is actually Jordan too, which I thought was pretty interesting. But I feel like also, like, they're gonna end up trying to paint him like he's a bad guy, but really he's just responding to the treatment that these people are doing on him. That's just my opinion. Like, just leave the dude alone, really. Then we get to the big storyline, which is the sacred fruit, this magical fruit that can make you immune to all magic, was stolen from the dryads at the Sacred Grove, and the dryads were all slaughtered. And they go see Abigail, and they're just like, did you do it? And she's like, no, I didn't do it. Would you guys just leave me alone? Again, they're very much bullies to everybody who is not a witch. And she's like, but you know who I do think did it? Parker, because he's leading all the demons now. And Maggie's like, no, it couldn't be, never. And it's like, no, he's leader of the demons. And the reason why he's leader of the demons is because Abigail created that dark master overlord kind of position and then left. And then the demons were looking for somebody to fill that slot. And of course he has the Cain name too. So he took it, but he thought Maggie was dead. Otherwise I'm sure he would have gone and found her, right? I don't know. I'm not 100% convinced of that. But essentially you get like a little glimpse into the demonic politics that are going on. Because as soon as Maggie shows up, Parker softens and his second in command immediately notices this and starts to work with Abigail in order to kind of undermine him and figure out if they can still trust him or if now Maggie is gonna be the one controlling him. And the second in command and Abigail kind of throw this kind of curveball at them and they make a big show of a bunch of stuff. You do find out that the second in command's the one who stole the sacred fruit and killed all the dryads, which was pretty cool. But in the process, you see both how cruel demons can be, but also how Maggie can change Parker. And Parker's like, well, why don't you stay with me and we can make this a new union, demons and witches, and we can make this a new future for both of our kinds. Will you marry me? And I was like, you know what? Respect. Respect. That was not only a good speech to make before proposing, but they were both like in bed naked and, you know, they had just made love and it was like, it was a beautiful moment. And like, yeah, that was the moment to ask her to marry him. But then of course it cuts away before we know what she says. My guess is she says yes, but it's not gonna go well. And then you find out that Abigail's like, well, yeah, we'll just have to kill my brother and take over the demon hordes again. I'm gonna go ahead and be the overlord again. And the second in command's like, okay. I mean, honestly, there were a whole lot of bombshells in this episode. There was a lot of emotional stuff going on between Parker and Maggie. And actually, it felt good to kind of have the two of them back together because they were the couple that I felt was the most believable from the first season. So I was like, okay, cool. I'm good with that. I like that combination of characters. They do seem to play well off of each other. There is chemistry between those two characters. Oh, and speaking of that, Macy and Harry seem to be having this weird kind of We have stuff that we should talk about. We should talk about Hazy, but we're not gonna talk about it. And it really just makes the entire episode kind of uncomfortable with them. So really, I feel like this is, I know that the next episode is the mid-season finale, and it's gonna be huge because they're gonna take a break in between for the holidays and stuff and then start back up after the weekend. But I really, really felt like this episode, again, was kind of an episode to kind of build, but there were still some big things to reveal. But also, it just felt super uncomfortable, and it was creating issues where I don't think it needed to be there, but I understand why they're there in order for the next episode to build up even further and leave you on a cliffhanger. So on the whole, I liked this episode. I don't think I liked it as much as the one before it. What did you guys think of episode 7? I really, really want to know. Let me know about that down in the comments. We'll continue the discussion down there. Otherwise, I've been your host, Aloy. This has been The Turnout. Thanks for showing up.